And as we go into our first quarter of our adoration time, we do have Psalm 100 we're going to do. And I'm just wondering if I could have a child volunteer come up real quick. Somebody from the children's ministry, come on up. Come on up. To help me lead this particular scripture. Come on, here we go. Is that your name?
Victoria.
Enunciation is very important for communication. Now we're going to read this. Can you read that back there?
Yes.
You're going to help we're all going to read it together, but you're going to help lead it, okay? All right, here we go. Ready? Along with Victoria. Here we go. Ready? And.
Shout. Joy.
Victoria. Adoration. So the A of Acts, or Acts acronym, is adoration. Putting into words, putting into song, putting into feelings, the praise. Whenever we discover, or remember, or remind ourselves of who God really is. And by doing so, this act restores God to his rightful place in our minds as the sovereign king of creation. When we catch a glimpse, we see how great and huge and magnificent and awesome God is, our hearts naturally are going to turn to praise and to adoration. Now, in a previous life, when I was younger, I was a Presbyterian. And we referred many times to the book called the Westminster Catechism. And in it, it says, man's chief end, or man's chief goal, is to glorify God and to enjoy God forever. Let me say that again. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy God forever. As we worship him, as we adore God, something happens on our inside. Now, we come to worship with lots on our mind from our week, okay? Peaks and valleys. Some of us come with heavy burdens, sickness and illnesses. Our worship of God doesn't make those totally go away. But when we understand who God is and praise him for who he is, it puts everything in our life into perspective. Understanding that he is sovereign over us. And our worship then becomes more upward focused than inward focused. In fact, Jesus knew how important adoration was, because when he taught the disciples the Lord's Prayer, the first thing he said was, "Our Father, who is in heaven, who art in heaven, hallowed or holy is your name." The very first thing he does is praise the Father. Father, you are holy. Adoring God reminds us of who he is. He is the creator. He is the Lord of heaven. And worshiping God reminds us of who it is that truly and without reservation, without any conditions, loves us and cares for us. Now, when I was doing my study of adoration a little bit, I came across these verses that kept saying, so-and-so-and-so shouted to the Lord. And then they shout to the Lord. You know, lots in Psalms a lot. Shout to the Lord. First Chronicles, praise the Lord, the God of Israel. And all the people shouted, amen. In fact, there's like 30 or 40 verses in the Bible that have to do with shouting. So if you think this is a really quiet thing, no, the Bible's a really loud thing. It's full of a lot of shouting and praising. Amen. Thank you. In fact, in 2 Chronicles, it says, then the Levites, a Levite, okay? The Levite was one of the tribes of Israel, Levi, and those people were the worship leaders. So our Levites this morning are here, and it said that the Levites shouted to God with a very loud shout. Let's do it. Ready? 1, 2, 3. What? We're shouting hallelujah. 1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah!
Oh my goodness. I think we've got to try to match the intensity of the Levites. Ready? On hallelujah. 1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah!
Okay. We're close, but I think we can try a little bit better than that. What are some of the other words maybe that we could shout out to God? Maybe some scripture comes to mind of a certain word. What are some of the words that we could shout out to God as praise to Him?
Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Worthy.
Worthy.
Love.
Love, your love. Anything, that's it? Got it wrapped up. Those don't have to be churchy words. Be like awesome, mighty, incredible, stupendous, magnificent. Okay? So, I want you to just... Amazing! Thank you, Victoria. I want you to think... I'm going to give you 5 seconds. Think of a word that you're going to shout. Okay? Think of a word that you're going to shout to God. In praise. This is, and we're not screaming, okay? We're just shouting. There's a difference. All right? So... So think of a word, hallelujah, hosanna, amazing, stupendous, love, whatever it is that you're going to praise to Him. This is a praise to Him. And on the count of three, we're all going to go together. Ready? Got your word? 1, 2, 3.
Hallelujah!
Great. You guys are so much more awesome than the first service because theirs went like that. And yours expanded. Actually, we're going to sing a song about shouting, and then when you get to the end, we're going to spend about 10 to 15 seconds just shouting our praises, these different words. I want you to shout and just acclaim to God how amazing He is. And you can, it can be one word over and over, a couple words, or just a sentence. You just say it out to Him as loud as you want. Now, you don't get this opportunity when Keith's here, right? So you have to do it when I'm here. So, so let's stand up as we sing our song. The next part of our journey this morning goes to the second letter of the acronym, and that is confession. That is confession. And to lead us off in our confession time, I need someone who can come up and help me lead Psalm 100, verse 3. Do I have any other person from the children's ministry who would like to do that? I see a hand. Do I see a hand? You can call on somebody? You know what, I tell you what, we'll see if they can get a little braver a little bit later in the service. Let's everybody together, Psalm 100, verse 2. Ready?
Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture.
How many people are familiar with the old saying, confession is good for the soul? Are you familiar with that? A parent invented that. I know, because I used to be a kid, and now I'm a parent, and I totally understand it. You know, when we do bad things, do we really want to go confess it? Hi, Mom, guess what? I hit Susie. No, we don't. Little Tommy, if he hits Susie, goes hiding behind the bed or in the garage or maybe down the street at his friend's house, you know, until he's found out, and he has to be brought back. Confession is not something that naturally comes to us. It's not a natural thing, but confession is putting words into and putting into words the sorrow and the brokenness of our soul. As we acknowledge, we own and declare our own guilt by admitting our own sins, committed first and foremost against God. Now, as we adore the living God, just got finished adoring the living God, we become aware of what? His holiness and our unholiness. We become aware of our own frailty and our sin. And we realize, oh, we really, really haven't been living as we should, we could have done. And that's something that we just really cannot avoid. Letting others down, letting ourselves down, and most importantly, we let God down. And so in confession, we tell God about these things and we ask forgiveness for that. Now, in order to better illustrate this, I think we need an illustration. In fact, I think we need a science experiment, right?
Yeah.
Who said, yeah? Okay, I want all the kids, you need to see this. So all the kids, people in, if you're in the children's ministry, age 15 grade and down, I need you to come forward and sit right here, okay? No, you're not part of the experiment. I'm not gonna experiment on you. You don't have to tell me all your sins. Come on, come on, I need all, come in the back row. Parents, you can come with them if they need some more support, okay? But you need to have a first, you need to be, you can be able to view this instead of sitting way in the back. You can be able to see. What? Middle schoolers can come. Absolutely, get over here. There we go. Or if you're a height challenged person, make sure that you can come and see that. You guys don't want to come? You're going to miss out on all the good stuff. Come on now, you can just sit on the floor right here. Okay? There's no splash zone. I know, honestly, I can tell you. Okay, here. You guys, come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Come on down. Here we go. Yeah, come on down. Here, you guys, scoot over. Scoot over. Make room for these guys. Samuel, right there, buddy. Right there. Thank you very much. Samuel and Emma. Samuel and Emma. Nice to meet you. My name is Dan. In case you missed it the first time. Okay, so here's our illustration. First thing we're going to put up is us. In fact, what we're going to put up is a representation of how God really made us. Okay? So this is, what does it say, everybody?
You.
You. Right. And what's inside there?
Fire.
And it's, what color is it?
Clear.
It's clear. It's beautiful. It's pristine.
It's
clean. Okay? This is the way God intended us to live. Right? Okay? Now, who made us?
God.
Right. Right. And who's the Son? Jesus. So we're going to bring up Jesus. All right? And Jesus is also without sin, right? The only person who ever lived. No sin, okay? He's pure and holy, all right? So that's Jesus. Now we're going to bring something else out here. Let's see if you know what it is, okay? It's going to be, well, can you turn the label around so they can see it? All right, let's see if you guys can guess what this is. You guess what that is?
Hell!
You're close, okay? It's sin. Okay, let's turn it around. You got it. Okay. The devil, sin, yeah. It's not pure and clean, is it? It's gross. Has it smell? Does it have a smell in there? Oh my gosh, this is terrible. This is terrible. Yeah. And you see, you don't want anything to do with that. However, we do kind of some bad things all the time, don't we? Like maybe a little lie to our parents or to a friend, or maybe we cheat on something, or we hurt somebody we don't mean to, but you know, it's the sin we can't avoid it. It's in our life, even adults. It's we're born into it. In fact, who were the first two people who experienced sin? Adam and Eve. Yeah, they came down looking like this, right? And then they got a little hungry and they started eating this apple, right? Then they ended up looking like this. Okay? In fact, let's show everybody what it looks like when sin comes into our life. Okay? Looks like orange Kool-Aid, and nobody likes that. Okay? Nobody likes that. Look at that. Oh.
It doesn't smell like orange Kool-Aid.
Oh, it's even worse. That's just terrible. So sin is in our life. And so God looks down and he says, oh my goodness, this jar isn't the way I made it. This jar is now full of all this gross, yucky, smelly stuff. And clean it up, guys. And no matter how hard we try to clean up this stuff that's inside it, we cannot do it. We cannot. Rolaids isn't going to do it, you know. And you can't filter it. Nothing. You're not going to. It's always going to look so gross.
Just empty it and fill it back.
No, you can't. Not even that works.
Same thing happens.
Same thing happens, you know. So God looked down and he said, you know what? I'm going to make a way for those people to have clear jars again, to have no sin in their life, okay? And so Jesus came down, and when we have Jesus in our life, when Jesus comes into our life, it takes the sin away. I think. Let's see if it does. What happens when Jesus comes into our life?
It gets clear.
Fantastic. That's exactly right. And not just our life, but everybody's life, everybody's jar. Jesus took on the whole world, all the jars. So when Jesus went to the cross and he died on the cross, that's when he took the sin into himself. Okay, the sin, he took that sin on himself so that he could go on the cross and make everybody clean. So this is what happened to sin when he was on the cross. He defeated death, didn't he? He came up and he rose out of the tomb on Easter Sunday, and he had defeated death, and now the jars are all clean. Let's have a big hand for Jesus, right? Yeah. So just remember that when sin comes into your life, Jesus is the one who can wipe that sin away. We sang that, didn't we? The very first song. Wash my sin away, oh, happy day. Yeah, that's what that's all about. Washing. Whenever you sing that song now in worship, and you can think about orange Kool-Aid, how it just goes away. All right? Kids, you can go back to sit with your parents and thank us. Have a big hand for it. Thank you very much. So, now we are going to go into our own time of confession. We have a time of a unison prayer here. And then we're going to let you have some time to make your own confession before God. Then we're going to sing a song and then have a pardon, assurance of pardon afterwards. So let's do this confession together. We want to touch the hem of your garment, O God. Forgive us for being afraid to touch those who come to us. We want to live the world. Forgive us for ignoring our neighbor. We long for peace. Forgive us for the pain we inflict on our families and friends. We want to share with those we love and like. Forgive us for walking past those who need you. Forgive us, loving God, that we do not excel in everything you call us to do. Give us grace to touch those who frighten us, to carry the bread of life to the hungry, to offer the blessings of the kingdom to everyone we meet, even as you have graced us in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let's be silent for a while in our own time. Next letter in the word Acts that we're going to look at is Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. We'll read Psalm 100, verse 4. Let's do that together. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. You know, I have got a confession as we move into Thanksgiving. And that is, when it comes to giving thanks, really bad. I have fantastic intentions. I think all the time, after some event or something's happened, or I need to send a thank you note, or I need to thank that person. And I say, oh, make a mental note. A mental note, right. Not for me. If I don't write down and do it right then or call that person up, something is going to squirrel my attention, okay? And, or something, I'm gonna get a phone call, something's gonna divert my attention, the busyness of my life, I know none of you are like that, to away from giving thanks to people. So I'll end up saying thank you to somebody for something they did a couple of years back. They'll just kind of gnaw at me and finally say, hey Mary, you remember that thing you did for me for that certain event? Well, thank you very much. And Mary will say, that was in 2013, dude. And yeah, but at least, thank you. So giving thanks doesn't really come naturally. I mean, confession doesn't come naturally, and giving thanks, well, I'm kind of gung-ho about it. It's something I kind of fall down on. And I think that if you look in the Bible, the Hebrews were kind of the same way, because there are many verses in Scripture where God had to tell them, hey, I want you to build an altar, okay? Build an altar to me and make a sacrifice and worship me here, so that whenever you come back, you will remember, okay? Or build this big tall pillar here and remember what happened here. Because he knew that if they didn't build it, there wasn't something they could see, they weren't going to remember that. Remembering is hard. In fact, our worship in the Old Testament and the New Testament is based on remembering one saving act. In the Old Testament, their worship was remembering what act? Remember? The Israelites were delivered out of Egypt. It was the Passover. And in the New Testament, it's Jesus on the cross. We remember those two acts when we worship. We remember who God is. And in Thanksgiving, they remember what he did for them. And Thanksgiving, you know, when we come out of confession and we realize that God has forgiven our sins, we have no alternative, really, than to just, it just kind of springs forth our gratitude for all that he's done for us. I love Psalm 136. It's a great psalm of thanksgiving, where it says, give thanks to the Lord forever, for he is good, his love endures forever. To him alone who does great wonders, his love endures forever. The psalm goes on and on, remembering about who God is and what he's done, and the affirmation that, yes, not just a temporary thing, his love endures forever. Listen to these psalms. And I will praise God's name with singing, and I will honor him with thanksgiving. Let us come to him with thanksgiving. Let us sing to him psalms of praise. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth, with thanksgiving. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving. So we're going to take some time right now to write our own thanksgivings. As you came in, you were handed a bulletin, and inside is a blank page for sermon notes. Write on one side for Thanksgiving. We're going to save the other side for a little bit later. If you don't have a piece of paper, I think that our head usher, the ushers do have extra pieces of paper. So as we're doing this, and the band will play music while we, very quietly, while we write down our Thanksgiving. But just write down things you're thankful for. If you need a piece of paper, raise your hand, and one of our usher crew will get you what you need. Let's just take a few minutes, write down your Thanksgiving. What are you thankful to God for? Amen. Now, the last letter in our acronym is S, and it stands for supplication. Woo! Let's all say that together. Ready?
Supplication.
Now, let's try it again.
Supplication. Okay.
Yes, I was just telling the band this morning that I took my vitamins and my supplications. Sorry, I had to sneak one dad joke in there, okay? supplications are not medicine or anything. A supplication, some when you ask for something, is a request, supplication. Like a supplicant is someone who asks for something. So we are asking God for something. Supplication is putting words to the request that we have to God, both personally, the ones we have for ourselves, and the ones that we pray for other people. You know, as Christians, we read in the scriptures, we really have what's called the priesthood of all believers, right? We don't have to go through an intermediary to talk to God. We have a direct line, okay? And so it is our responsibility with our direct line, not just to pray for ourselves, but to pray for others as well. Because that's how we care for each other, is as the church, as the body of Christ. We bring our petitions. So what I want to do is spend some time writing down prayer requests. Now, this piece of paper we're not handing in. I'm not asking you to hand this paper in a little bit later so I can read all your prayer requests and your thanksgivings, as entertaining as that would be. But no, I want you to take these home and make these be for your own private worship during this coming week. Written down your Thanksgiving, write down your prayer requests during this next time that we have together. That includes all the kids. Write down your prayer requests. If you have a hard time writing it down, ask your brother or sister, your parents sitting next to you to help you write that down, all right? It's very important. If you need some help thinking about things to write down, here we go. How can you pray for yourself this week? How can you pray for others, both in the church and in the community? That's one thing you can do. How can you pray for our nation? How can you pray for our world? And maybe we also need to ask God, what do you want to do with my life? What do you want to do with my life this week, this month, my life? Lord, what do you want from our church? What do you want Kent Covenant to be? How do I fit into that? As Kent Covenant exists in Kent, it's a part of our nation, it's a part of our world. All right? So spend a few moments writing down your own prayer requests that you'll be looking at this coming week. And then we're going to sing a song and have some prayer at the end. I'll have some guided prayer for us at the end. As the band plays, hear these prayers that we pray for our fellow worshipers and for our family and our church family. Hear the prayers we offer for those who are sick and in need of healing. Hear the prayers that we pray for our community, for our workplaces and our fellow workers, for our schools and our classmates and our teachers. Lord, hear the prayers that we pray for our nation, for our world, for your creation. Lord, hear these things, and we pray them in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. We put the Lord's Prayer on the screen for you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have been together today worshiping. We've been together singing and praying and being silent and shaking hands. And now it is time to do those things in this world and be God's hands and feet and be what he has called us to be in a world that is unfriendly to that. So let us go with grace through the power of the Holy Spirit to be his people. And so to end up, I want us to sing the doxology. If you don't know what the doxology is, we're going to put it on the screen for you. This is a great song for all of us to learn based on our scripture for today. And in a symbol of unity, I want us all to reach out and take the hand of those who are standing next to you. Reach across the aisle if you can, okay? So that we can all reach together. And even the Levites here are going to, okay? Then we go. Everybody got hands? Here we go.